Hello and welcome to this presentation about Amazon Web Services data lakes and enabling access to data lakes on AWS through SAS. My name is Dilip Rajan and I'm a partner solutions architect with AWS. I work with various ISVs in the data and analytics verticals to build joint solutions and integrations with AWS. I've been in the company for just over 4 years, and I've worked in various industries from e-banking to fulfillment operations. In this presentation, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about data lakes on AWS, how to build data lakes on AWS using Lake Formation, which is a service that went live last year. And I'm going to also talk to you about some of the frequent data lake patterns and analytics on AWS and how users can interact with AWS data lakes in a seamless way. As you know, the data that has been available nowadays has increased exponentially in the last 4 to 5 years. And because the data has exploded, it has caused a variety of challenges in terms of making the data democratized, as well as making sure that the right governance and control capabilities are available for data to be available in a seamless fashion. These challenges are important challenges that happen in any organization where there is a large amount of data that comes in from internal and external sources. In AWS, we think about a data lake as a centralized and a secure repository where users can analyze wide variety of data sets using simple mechanisms to discover and govern those shared data sets. Both data sets from a structured and unstructured fashion, such as Apache Parquet formats, are available in a data lake. And they can be also accessed via open source analytical frameworks such as Apache Spark. In the world of AWS, there are a variety of services that help build a data lake. At the center of all of this is the object storage of S3. S3 allows for all of the data to be stored in a centralized repository. However, it also provides the ability to interact with multiple services within the portfolio of AWS. For example, in order to move data into S3, it is important that we have integrations with Kinesis, which is the streaming service, as well as Snowball, which can help in loading data in a batch-wise fashion. Same time, you have AWS Glue that can help with the cataloging and searching of that data once it's available in S3. User interface services such as AppSync, API Gateway, and Cognito allow for interaction through a visual interface to the data sets in S3. And finally, this data set is available via analytical services such as Athena, Redshift, EMR, Glue, and QuickSight. Stitching all of these things together, is once it's done, it's important that we have the right permissions and compliance model, which can be enforced through AWS IAM, Identity and Access Management. And once the Identity and Access Management framework has been set up, monitoring and logging of access can be enabled through CloudWatch and CloudTrail. Building a data lake is not an easy task. It can take months for a team of data engineers, data security officers, and data scientists to set up the storage, move the data there, clean and prep the data through a catalog, enforce the right permission policies, and make the data available for the data scientists. Having the necessary infrastructure and then removing these silos of interaction between multiple teams can be a cumbersome process, and this is not that something that makes it easy for organizations to set up and operationalize a data lake quickly. Last year, AWS launched Lake Formation, which allows users to set up data lakes in a matter of weeks. It provides the three pillars of setting up a data lake in terms of ingestion and cleaning, security, analytics, and ML. And within ingestion and cleaning, the building block there is in terms of AWS Glue, which provides a framework to write the workflows of moving data from source to destination using serverless Spark. This framework is built on top of blueprints. Blueprints are nothing but pre-computed, pre-developed templates that allow for data to be moved between source to the destination. We won't go through ML transforms, but in ML transforms, there is ability to dedupe data and clean that lots of data sets in ML transforms. In this presentation, I'll also show you a workshop link that will allow the users to set up a data lake from the basic components to analyzing the data in a cohesive fashion. So we'll take a look at that workshop towards the end of the presentation. It's important to look into what are the main components of Glue, because Glue is the building block on top of which lake formation is built. Glue has three main components of a data catalog, a serverless engine, and an orchestration model that stitches all of these workflows together. Within the data catalog, it provides the capability to automatically crawl and discover the metadata from the underlying S3 datasets in a Hive-compatible data store. Once the metadata has been discovered, it has the capability to interact with other AWS services, which allow it to discover these metadata and provide them for search and cataloging capabilities. The same capabilities are also available similarly in the serverless engine, where users can use Apache Spark or Python shell scripts to build jobs either for interactive purposes or for batch purposes. And once these jobs are set up, there is an orchestration model that allows users to build a workflow using a visual designer on the AWS console. Stitching up all of this together, once the workflows are set up, there is a mechanisms in place for monitoring and alerting of various workflows and how those workflows are implemented at the base level. Let's take a look at how lake formation builds on top of AWS Glue. For lake formation itself, there are three main components. One is the monitoring component, the blueprints, and then security, collaboration, and search. For the blueprints, as you can see, the blueprints are nothing but preformed templates that allow data to be moved from source to destination. And that's built on top of workflows, and workflows are built on top of ETL jobs and the Glue crawlers. So you can see that the core components of workflows builds into a blueprint. Similarly, to search and collaborate on data sets, you need to have a Glue data catalog. And once the Glue catalog has been built, lake formation is layered on top of it with the security and collaboration capabilities. Putting all of this together helps with monitoring, where any access to a lake formation can be monitored on the dashboard of lake formation. In order for us to understand how the data is moved from source to destination, let's take a look into how data is loaded through blueprints. Blueprints are nothing but pre-built templates that serve very common use cases of ingestion. For example, you might have data that moves from OLTP databases such as Amazon RDS, or from access logs in CloudTrail or from ELB. Once that data is available, a Glue workflow automatically is built using a blueprint. And the crawlers and jobs automatically discover and transform the structured data from the source. A Glue catalog is populated, and all of the data can be then loaded from the source to the destination S3 buckets in incremental or full fashion. This is how the data is moved from source to destination in commonly built use cases. Once the data has been moved into the centralized location, permission models are overlaid on top. This is an example of how a user might want to get access to the underlying data sets using common common analytical tools such as Redshift, Glue, EMR, and Athena. Once the user asks for data access, a lake formation call is made, and the permissions which have already been overlaid by the administrator are provided, and the user gets access to the data in the underlying data lake. It's also important to understand how the data is available at various levels. In previous data lakes, you would notice that you would have had to deploy the permissions at a bucket level. However, with the lake formations, permissions can be specified on tables as well as columns. This permission model also allows users to grant and revoke permissions, and also see all of the view permissions at one particular location. At the same time, it also provides the ability for folks to see what kind of access is available and audit that access whenever there might be some challenges to user access. It's also important to understand the capabilities of data catalog and metadata management within lake formation. Lake formation allows users to perform text-based search. It also allows users to add attributes, for example, who could be a data owner, a data steward, and add additional table properties. And also, at the same time, the users can also get access to look at the data which is available in those tables using Amazon Athena. It's super important that we have the ability to monitor and audit all of the access to a lake formation or to an underlying data lake in real time. As you can see in this example, there is detailed activity for CloudTrail to track each and every one of the audit logs. And from CloudWatch, we can create notifications and publications to how the data is being ingested into a data lake and perform any root cause analysis or investigations if there are certain issues or challenges with monitoring and managing that real-time activity. Let's take a look at some of the comprehensive set of integration tools. AWS has a pre-built interaction for lake formation with Redshift, EMR, Glue, and Athena. These tools have the necessary systems in place and the necessary API access to provide the permission access via permission models. And all of the access can be logged and tracked within lake formation itself. For the purposes of this presentation, I'm going to go through Amazon Athena and see how Athena interacts with the lake formation and some of the benefits that Athena provides. Athena is an interactive query service. It's a standard SQL-based interface that allows access to the underlying data in S3. Some of the key benefits of Athena are that it is a decoupled storage and compute environment. It's a serverless model that has no infrastructure or cost setup. Customers are only required to pay for the amount of data they scan. And it is a compliant product from other open source file formats and also is built upon powerful open source community-based solutions. A recent addition to this feature set of Athena was the federated query that allows users to interact with multiple querying engines behind the scenes. And this is a powerful capability that adds benefits to Amazon Athena. Athena is a familiar technology under the covers. For example, users can still use the DDL capabilities of create or alter table, have support for multiple data types, multiple formats, and it supports data partitioning, which allows for improved and faster access to the data, which is available in S3. It uses in-memory database distributed engine of Presto, and which is pretty much the same as writing a standard SQL code. Users can take a look at some of the Presto-based SQL. Here you can see an example of how Presto SQL can be written. It provides the same capabilities of standard SQL, such as joins, nested queries, and windowing functions, and supports multiple file formats, such as arrays and structures and maps. There are file formats such as Presto, Avro, and Org are also supported in addition to CSV and JSON. And ultimately, it has strong interaction and integration with AWS Data Catalog. Now that we have seen about a few of the services, including Glue, Lake Formation, and Athena that form the nuts and bolts of a data lake, let's take a look at what are the mechanisms that are available for SAS users to interact with AWS Data Lake. SAS has many tools and many products, and it is important that we have a common talking mechanism with AWS Data Lake. For Athena, which is an ODBC and JDBC compliance service, we have SAS access interface to ODBC JDBC that can be layered on top of your SAS toolkit. In addition, there is also the native capabilities of Proc S3, which allows access to S3 buckets using access keys and secret keys. For data sets which are large in number, the native capabilities of S3 in terms of transfer acceleration can also be used for accessing the data sets and loading and unloading data in a very speedy fashion. For Redshift Spectrum, there is the native capability of downloading an ODBC, JDBC driver from Redshift that can allow for interaction between your SAS tools and AWS data lakes via Redshift Spectrum. And at the same time, you also have the ability of using SAS access interface to ODBC, JDBC, or the SAS access interface to Redshift. There are various benefits of using one mechanism over the other in terms of speed and performance, and users should typically take into consideration various workload requirements before making a decision of which mechanism is the most suitable for their workload on a day-to-day basis. Finally, I want to take you through the link to the workshop that I talked to you before. In this architecture or in this workshop, you can actually see how a MySQL data source, which contains a few data sets that are being updated from logs, etc., are loaded to an S3 bucket using a Glue workflow that contains the Glue job and the Glue caller. There are various personas in terms of admin, developer, and business analyst, who can then set up the architecture and also have the ability to interact with the data sets in S3 and then store those resultant data sets in S3 as well. So this is a good workshop that can give you a hands-on experience of what is required to set up a data lake using Lake Formation. We are constantly looking for feedback on how to improve either the workshop or the service interaction between SAS and AWS. And we'd love to hear about your feedbacks and your questions. I welcome your questions, and feel free to interact with me. Please note down my email address and let us know how we can improve the interaction between AWS Data Lakes and SAS. And we can take that back to our product engineering teams and improve the product offerings that currently exist between SAS and AWS. Thank you, and have a good day.